very welcome to our worship service today. Thank you for joining with us. I pray we'll all sense God's presence and we'll rely on his help to worship him in spirit and in truth. If you're visiting with us, we give you a special welcome. Some Sundays it's a struggle to get enough praise items to fit in with the theme of the service. Today there was an abundance of praise items, and that's why we had a couple of praise items just playing there while we were gathering for worship. I have three announcements today. First of all, our midweek meeting is on Wednesday at 8 p.m. in the main hall. We'll be continuing our little series entitled Living Christianity by looking at gender, life, marriage, and family. Now, you know that these are four of the most controversial subjects in our society today. So I encourage you to come along and hear what the Bible has to say about them so that you'll be equipped to recognize how our society is seeking to deviate away from God's plans. That'll also help you as you seek to speak to people who have misunderstandings in these areas. In line with the most recent guidelines we've received from Church House, everyone attending our midweek meeting is encouraged to wear a face covering. God willing, our worship services will continue here in our meeting house next Lord's Day at 11 a.m. And then our next congregational walk is at Doan on Saturday the 19th of September. This is classified as a moderate walk. We'll meet in the church car park at 10 a.m. and we'll return about 2 p.m. So if you would like to go, please contact Claire Woods. Sonia's now going to say a word about PW.
Good morning, everyone. You'll find on your seats there's a wee flyer that gives you some information about our PW meetings for the next few months. Now, they've been quarantined, they've been there since Wednesday, so we've fulfilled the 72-hour rule that we have for materials and so on. The committee have met, and we have planned a programme for the whole year, but obviously we have to make plans very tentatively at the moment because of the COVID restrictions. So on your sheet you will find what we hope to be able to do coming in the next months coming up to Christmas. We're going to meet in the hall at 8 o'clock. The hall has been laid out, the seats are laid out socially distanced. There will be hand sanitizer as you come in, and we will be asked to wear face coverings. We won't be able to have a cup of tea, which is a big disappointment, but that's where we're at. But we would love you to come along. Our theme for this year is Side by Side. And the idea is that as women, well, as a congregation, as people in a congregation, we should be coming alongside one another. But our theme for the women's ministry in particular this year is Side by Side. And it really is the idea of coming alongside one another to encourage, to support, to befriend. And that's what we hope to do with our meetings. So the first one that's planned for Wednesday week, the 16th of September, there's a lady coming from the J29 project in Banbridge, which provides a food bank ministry, among other things. So she's coming to tell us a bit about that, and also to do a little Bible study as well. So we would love you to come along to encourage one another just by your presence, being there. We will be able to hopefully have a socially distant chat as we wait for people to gather in and so on. So we would value you to come. I think more than ever now, because of COVID-19 and us having to be locked down for so many months, we need to be side by side. We need to be encouraging one another and taking the opportunities to do that in the way that we can under the current guidelines. So if you're a gentleman here this morning, feel free to take the sheet and pass it on to ladies that you know who may be interested in coming along. But also take it and pray for the meetings, please. Pray that we'll have wisdom. As we plan ahead, as we move forward, pray for those who'll be coming to speak, and just pray that God's protection upon us as we seek to meet together to worship him, to glorify him, and to encourage one another. Thank you.
Thank you, Sonia. The Apostle John tells us in the book of Revelation that the four living creatures in heaven never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." And whenever the living creatures give glory and honour and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honour and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." When we truly realise who God is, the only proper response is to worship him. We have gathered here today to worship the same perfectly holy, eternal Lord God Almighty, who created all things, that the living creatures and the elders in heaven continually worship. It blows my mind that when we meet to worship, we're joining with the people in heaven, the creatures in heaven, to worship God. So let's do that as we praise him using the words of our opening hymn, "Holy, holy, holy." And this hymn is based on that call to worship that we had from the book of Revelation. Let us stand to praise God.
Our song shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity. Holy, holy, casting down their golden crowns around the glassy sea, cherubim and seraphim falling down before thee, which work and are and evermore shall be.
We will continue to adore God as we come to him in prayer. And as we focus on his perfect character, we'll acknowledge our sinful character, and we'll thank God for assuring us that he forgives all who are truly repentant. So let us bow before God with our prayer of adoration, confession, and thanksgiving. Great God, we bless you for exalting your name and your word above all things. Enable us to grasp something more of the magnificence of your multifaceted character and to submit to the authority of your never-changing word. We recognize that you are the perfectly holy Lord God Almighty, who the creatures and saints in heaven constantly praise with those words, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they were created and have their being. Thank you that we can join with them to worship you this morning. We praise you as the only living and true God. Yet we recognize that you are God in three persons, the Blessed Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the same in substance and equal in power and glory. We bless you for being a merciful God, as well as a holy God, because we are sinners who have disobeyed you in thought, word, and deed. In our sinful state, we would be consumed by your awesome holiness. Today, we particularly confess the ways in which our worship has been unacceptable to you. Forgive us for the times when we chose to do other things instead of worshiping you. Forgive us for the times when we half-heartedly worshiped you because we allowed our mind to wander to all sorts of places. Forgive us for the times when we worshiped you with our lips, but our hearts were far from you. Forgive us for the times we forgot that worship is all about your glory rather than our preferences. Forgive us for the times when our worship of you has not been reflected in our daily life. Since your word warns that the wages of our sin is eternal death, we are so thankful that you graciously promise to give the gift of eternal life to those who look to you for forgiveness through faith in what Jesus accomplished for them. We bless you for the perfect life and sacrifice of Jesus. Thank you that he paid in full the price of redemption for his people. We praise you that he is alive, and you have exalted him to the highest place, giving him the name that is above every name. Seated at your right hand in heaven, Jesus waits for the moment when you command him to return to make all things new. We bless you for the work of the Holy Spirit, who convicts us of sin, righteousness, and judgment to come. We ask that he would deal with each one of us here today. Help us all to worship you sincerely, rather than just go through the motions of another worship service. In Jesus' glorious name, we pray all these things. Amen. Please turn to Isaiah chapter 6 in your Bibles. This passage describes Isaiah's experience of God in the temple and how Isaiah responded to that experience. And you'll see the seraphim here in Isaiah 6 saying the same thing as the living creatures said in heaven in Revelation, as we saw in our call to worship. So Isaiah chapter 6, beginning to read at verse 1. And this is the living word of the living God we're reading together. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying, and they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried. "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away, and your sin atoned for." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." He said, "Go and tell this people, be ever hearing, but never understanding, be ever seeing, but never perceiving. Make the heart of this people calloused. Make their ears dull and close their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn and be healed. Then I said, for how long, O Lord? And he answered, until the cities lie ruined and without inhabitant, until the houses are left deserted and the fields ruined and ravished, until the Lord has sent everyone far away and the land is utterly forsaken. And though a tenth remains in the land, it will again be laid waste. But as the terebinth and oak leave stumps when they are cut down, so the holy seed will be the stump in the land. Amen. And we praise God for his living word by which we are born again. Our second hymn is His Mercy Is More. And this hymn expresses our gratitude to God for the mercy that he demonstrates to us in forgiving our sins. We're going to keep our seats. We're going to look at the words of this hymn as the video plays, All Being Well.
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy. Sins, they are.
The boys and girls can now leave for Children's Church, and it's in the minor hall this week. Having thanked God for his grace, we desire to see more of his grace in our lives and in the lives of others. So let us bring our prayers of intercession before God's throne of grace. Let us pray. Lord of time, over these past few weeks, we have witnessed things opening up and speeding up again after the emergency stop of lockdown. As we and everything around us becomes increasingly busy, help us to remember that you are the patient God who took 6 days to create the universe when you could have done it in an instant. You're the patient God who waited for the fullness of time to come before you sent your Son to redeem your people. You're the patient God who builds your kingdom gradually, just like a mustard seed becomes a tree, and just like yeast spreads through a batch of dough. Enable us to move at the pace of your grace and to keep in step with the Spirit's leading, so that we prioritize what you declare to be important and we treasure what you say is valuable. Progressively reveal your will to our hearts and your wisdom to our minds, so that we continually live to please you, and so that we serve you well in our congregation as well as in our daily lives. Loving Father, we know from your word that your grace is sufficient for all our needs. Thank you that we can have confidence in your ability to help us. Forgive us for the times when we have depended on our own strength instead of depending on yours. Help us to remember that you're able and willing to equip us for all that you ask us to do as individuals and as a congregation of your people. All-powerful God, the reality is sinking in that our country is not going to be free from COVID-19 and its effects for a very long time. So the only way we can be spared from being anxious about this is by continuing to pray about the situation. We praise you for promising that if we respond in this way, your peace, which passes all understanding, will guard our hearts and minds. Enable our executive and its advisors to look to you for wisdom about how to reduce the number of new coronavirus cases that are emerging each day. Enable our health service to cope with the increased testing that is taking place and to give the right treatment to those who test positive. Also help the National Health Service to maintain the services that other patients require. Be especially close to the staff and the patients in Craigavon Area Hospital, as well as their families. Enable the coronavirus clusters that have been identified there to be brought under control. Sovereign Lord, we ask that you would enable those who are continuing to negotiate a Brexit settlement to find one that preserves good working relationships between the United Kingdom and the European Union, as well as between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. We pray that you'd undertake for those who will be most impacted by Brexit, including businesses and the farming sector that are already under pressure because of the crisis caused by COVID-19. Also help those who live in border communities to plan and prepare for what is ahead. God of the Church, we praise you for the excellent guidance and support we have received from the staff and Church House about how to deal with the circumstances associated with the coronavirus. We pray that you'd particularly bless our clerk, Reverend Trevor Gribben, and all who work with him as they continually seek to implement the latest information they receive from our government. As church staff who were furloughed gradually return to work part-time, enable them to quickly adapt to their new working environment. Great Physician, we bring before you those members of our church family and others we know who are ill at this time. We bless you for being the God who has secured an eternity of perfect health for all who trust in you. One day, all the ways that the fall has impacted our bodies, our emotions, and our mind will be healed. Groans will give way to glory, and there will be no more pains. There will just be praise. So enable those we love to trust in your plan of salvation and to constantly rely on your grace. Almighty, gracious Father, for as much as our whole salvation depends upon our true understanding of your holy word, grant to all of us that our hearts, being freed from worldly affairs, may hear and apprehend your holy word with all diligence and faith, that we may rightly understand your gracious will, cherish it, and live by it with all earnestness, to your praise and honor, through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Back at the end of February, I was privileged to be able to undertake a week of in-service training. As part of this training, I attended a conference organized by the Westminster Fellowship. The first day of this conference focused on Christ-centered worship. After the conference was over, I read a book on Christ-centered worship, which the speaker at the conference had written. And in the remainder of the week, I studied some other resources on worship. I found all of this very helpful in helping me to understand and think about what we do when we gather to worship God and why we do it. So please have your Bibles open there at Isaiah chapter 6 so that you can follow what God is saying to us through his word today. There are many lessons we can learn from Isaiah chapter 6, but today we're going to focus on what this passage has to teach us about worship, and then we'll see how we can apply this to our situation here. Isaiah chapters 1 to 5 are Isaiah's introduction to his book. This introduction raises the question, how can the arrogant, defiant Israelites ever become the pure, undefiled people through whom the nations can learn about God? In chapter 6, Isaiah offers how God dealt with him as the answer to that question. Isaiah says there in verse 1, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on a throne, high and exalted, and the train of his robe filled the temple. King Uzziah died around about 740 BC. Uzziah had been a strong and effective king. However, God had inflicted Uzziah with leprosy when he grew proud and he ignored God's holiness by trying to play the part of a priest in the temple. You can read about that incident in 2 Chronicles chapter 26. Uzziah's death brought to an end a long period of prosperity for God's people in the kingdom of Judah. So his death undoubtedly plunged the nation into a time of mourning and crisis. This may be the reason why Isaiah went to the temple. During this visit to the temple, God chose to assure Isaiah that he was still sovereignly reigning, even though the throne of the country was empty. He did this by giving Isaiah a vision of the high and exalted Lord sitting on his throne. The fact that the train of the Lord's robe filled the temple in Isaiah's vision indicates the immensity of our God. It may also be a picture of what the seraph said at the end of verse 3 about the Lord's glory filling the earth. Just in passing, the opening verse of this passage reminds us that no matter what personal or national or international crisis engulfs us, it's under God's control because he sovereignly rules over everyone, everything, everywhere, all of the time. The situation we find ourselves in may have come as a shock to us, and it may be confusing or disappointing or costly or painful, but it didn't take God by surprise. So we should turn to him for help to deal with that situation. In verse 2, Isaiah goes on to tell us what he saw in the temple. Above the Lord were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. The origin of the Hebrew word that's translated as seraphs suggests that these angelic beings have the appearance of flames. Their six wings indicate they have supernatural power. The fact that they use two of those wings to cover their face and two to cover their feet let us know that even perfect supernatural beings humble themselves before the all-holy God who created them, and they cannot look at him. According to verse 3, Isaiah heard these awesome creatures call out to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." In English, we use superlatives when we're comparing things. For example, when it comes to height, we use tall, taller, and the tallest. However, in Hebrew, superlatives are indicated by repeating the word. So instead of saying the holiest, the word holy is repeated three times to convey the absolute moral purity and separateness of God above his creation. We saw in our studies of Revelation that in Scripture, three represents completeness. As well as declaring God's perfect holiness, the seraph states that the whole earth is full of his glory. God's glory is his presence with his chosen people. And God's glory was most clearly demonstrated by Jesus coming to live amongst us. Isaiah informs us in verse 4 that at the sound of the seraph's voices, the doorposts and the threshold shook and the temple was filled with smoke. This gives us a glimpse of the power of these angelic beings and the intensity of their worship of the all-holy God. What Isaiah learned about God through what he saw and heard in the temple that day had a profound effect upon him. Look at verse 5. "Woe to me," Isaiah cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Being confronted with God's perfectly holy character led Isaiah to recognize the sinfulness of his own character. While the worship of the seraphs was pure, Isaiah acknowledged that what came from his lips and from the lips of his people was displeasing to God because it was sinful. When Isaiah saw the true and eternal King sitting on his throne, this revealed what Isaiah was like in comparison to him. Thankfully, Isaiah wasn't left in despair. He tells us in verses 6 and 7, "One of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, 'See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for.'" The altar was where sacrifices were offered. All the sacrifices in the Old Testament pointed forward to Jesus, whom John the Baptist pointed to and described as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The seraph applied God's gracious remedy for Isaiah's sin personally to him. When the holy coal from the altar touched Isaiah's unclean mouth, it didn't hurt him. It healed him. So the seraphs could confidently declare that God's cure for Isaiah's sin was completely sufficient and immediately effective. Through Jesus' once-for-all sacrifice on the cross, God has provided the only way whereby the sin and guilt of all those who trust Jesus to be their Savior can be removed and atoned for. When Isaiah's sin had been confessed by him and forsaken by God, he was qualified to tell the world about God's grace, which is the only hope that this world has. According to verse 8, Isaiah heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" To which Isaiah responded, "Here am I. Send me." Notice that the Lord asks, "Who will go for us?" This reminds us that the Godhead is made up of three persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who are the same in substance and equal in power and glory. God the Father makes our worship Christ-centered by redeeming us through the work of his Son and by giving us his Spirit to testify of his Son. In verses 9 and 10, God clearly explained to Isaiah what his work among his people would entail. The Lord said, "Go and tell this people, be ever hearing, but never understanding. Be ever seeing, but never perceiving. Make the heart of this people calloused. Make their ears dull and close their eyes. Otherwise they might see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their hearts, and turn and be healed." The spiritual condition of Isaiah's generation was so bad that God told Isaiah the truth which he would proclaim to them would only harden the majority of them in their sinful ways. That isn't the sort of calling that any of us would jump at. And these verses are quoted in the New Testament in several places to explain why so many people still reject the good news about Jesus. Every time we hear God's word preached, we come away from that exposure to his truth either more softened towards God or more hardened towards God. Either a little closer to God or a little further away from God. We never come away from it just the same as we came to it. This emphasizes that saving faith is a gracious gift from God. Isaiah wasn't put off by the difficulty of the task God was calling him to. His only question was, how long was his ministry to last? The Lord replied in verses 11 to 13, "Until the cities lie ruined and without inhabitant, until the houses are left deserted and the fields ruined and ravished, until the Lord has sent everyone far away and the land is utterly forsaken. And though a tenth remains in the land, it will again be laid waste. But as the terebinth and oak leave stumps where they are cut down, so the holy seed will be the stump in the land." God's answer to Isaiah's question was sobering. The only hope for Isaiah's generation was through destruction and exile. However, the very last thing God said to Isaiah is the encouragement that comes there at the end of verse 13. God's discipline would leave a remnant of people who would be his holy seed, and they would act like a stump that's been left after a forest has been cut down and burned over. These remaining believers would be set apart for God by the same grace that had saved Isaiah. And they would carry on the work of bearing God's wisdom to the nations. Ultimately, Jesus would come from this remnant. Despite the difficulty of the task, Isaiah could take God's message to his people, knowing that God was with him, and more than that, God would bless his ministry so that it accomplished the purpose God had for it. Now you may be wondering what Isaiah's encounter with God in the temple about 2,760 years ago has to do with what we do here in Magherally on a Sunday. To answer that question, we'll look again at what Isaiah experienced in the temple and how he responded to it. At each stage, I'll point out how the components of our worship services reflect what Isaiah experienced and how he responded to it. Isaiah chapter 6 begins with Isaiah recognizing the glory and holiness of God. And this is reflected in our worship service by our call to worship, our opening hymn, and the first part of our opening prayer. Because these all focus on some aspects of God's character. The recognition of God's character led Isaiah to confess his sin. In the second part of our opening prayer, we confess some of the ways we have sinned against God. The third thing that's contained in Isaiah chapter 6 is assurance of God's grace. Our opening prayer continues with an assurance from Scripture that God forgives our sin when we confess it to him. This assurance of forgiveness can also be a separate statement after the opening prayer. When God cleansed Isaiah of his sin and assured Isaiah of his mercy, Isaiah responded with grateful devotion. And this is reflected in the last part of our opening prayer, in our second hymn, in our offering, and in our prayers of intercession. The fifth thing that's contained in Isaiah chapter 6 is instruction from God to equip Isaiah to minister God's word to his people. And this is obviously reflected in our sermon. Isaiah chapter 6 concludes with the promise that God would bless Isaiah's ministry, even though it would be difficult, and Isaiah would see little fruit for his labor. And this is reflected in our final hymn and our benediction. I hadn't realized until I spent some time studying the structure of a worship service that the benediction is a blessing which is pronounced rather than a prayer which is offered. So it's to be pronounced and received with our eyes open. We respond to God's charge to obey the instruction we have received from his word by moving forward and moving outward, trusting that he'll ultimately accomplish his goodwill according to his promise to bless us, to keep us, and to give us the peace of his grace. This structure isn't just found in Isaiah chapter 6. We also see it in Deuteronomy chapter 5, when the Israelites were assembled on Mount Sinai. We see it in 2 Chronicles chapters 5 to 7, at the dedication of the temple which Solomon built. This structure is also found in Paul's epistles, because they were written to be read in the corporate worship of the churches they were addressed to, so that congregation would understand the gospel and its implications for their lives. We need to continually remind ourselves that worship isn't about us. It's not about what we prefer or what we get out of it. Worship is about the glory of God, which we see most clearly in the face of Jesus. So our worship should show the face of Jesus to those who have gathered to worship him and to those who need to gather to worship him. While the message of the gospel should clearly influence the individual parts of a worship service, the way the elements of a worship service are arranged should also proclaim the gospel. This means that in every aspect, corporate worship should be a presentation of the gospel in the presence of God and his people for his glory and for our good. When our worship glorifies God, he will use it to strengthen us. Just in passing, this structure isn't just a biblical pattern for our worship services. This is also a biblical description of how the gospel progresses in our individual lives by God's grace. Our worship is separated from Isaiah's worship by time and distance. But we're worshiping the same God that Isaiah worshiped, and we're worshiping him in the same way because our worship is based on and shaped by the same gospel message as Isaiah's worship was. We need to remember that the gospel isn't just an evangelism plan. It's the message of how the good news of God's provision affects all aspects of our lives every day. The gospel isn't just the story of God's saving acts in the past. It's the story of how those actions give us confidence for today and hope for tomorrow. It's important that we understand what we do in a worship service and why we do it, rather than just go through the motions every week. By our worship, we embrace, we commend, and we share the story of the gospel. We begin with adoration so that all recognize the greatness and the goodness of God. In light of his glory, we acknowledge our sin and confess our need of God's grace. Assurance of pardon by God produces thanksgiving within us. Sincere thanksgiving enables us to become aware that all we have is from God and that we depend upon him for every good thing in our lives. And this compels us to seek God in prayer for our needs and for the advancement of his kingdom. The realization of God's loving provision for us makes us long for instruction from his word so that we love what he loves and we love who he loves. We obey God's instruction knowing that we're both charged by him to do so and assured of his blessing as we live for him. Proper worship honors the gospel and communicates the gospel clearly. On the other hand, we dishonor the gospel if we worship in a way that distorts the gospel. If we seek to faithfully present the gospel through our worship services, God will maintain the testimony of his truth and communicate his grace through us despite all our weaknesses, limitations, and failures. Each week I'll try to point out some of the various components of our worship service so that we remember why we're doing what we're doing. Let's come to God now in prayer and thank him for instructing us from his word and seek his help to put it into practice in our lives. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, thank you for showing us from your word what true worship is. Help us to worship you sincerely every day as we spend time studying your word and speaking to you in prayer. And as we join as a church family to worship you every Lord's Day. Use these times in your presence to equip us to take the good news of your grace to those we interact with in our daily life. In Jesus' all-powerful name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is, How Shall They Hear Who Have Not Heard? This hymn is based on Isaiah chapter 6. It helps us to respond to what God has taught us about our need to take the good news of God's grace out to those who need to hear it. Let us stand to worship God.
Sent in prayer. self-centered soul. Touch but my lips, my hands, my heart, and make a world for Christ my goal. Spirit of love within us move. Spirit of truth in park and land, so shall they hear and find and prove Christ is their life, their joy, their pride.
May the Lord make your love increase and overflow for each other and for everyone else. May he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. Amen.